Well, good afternoon, everyone. This is the last panel of the 2023 Presidential Sites Summit, but just because it's the last, certainly doesn't mean it's the least. In fact, I expect this one to be the best. So there's a standard of expectation for you there. On March 31st, 1776, Abigail Adams wrote to her husband, John, on paper, but I will read from my iPhone. I long to hear that you have declared an independency. And by the way, in the new code of laws, which I suppose it will be necessary for you to make, I desire you would remember the ladies and be more generous and favorable to them than your ancestors. Well, this afternoon, we're not going to only remember the ladies, we're going to celebrate the ladies, celebrate the first ladies. Now, any of you who have heard me talk or speak know that I'm a significant fan of Jacqueline Kennedy because she is the founder of the White House Historical Association. And I believe without her and her leadership and her legacy, we wouldn't be here today. And that extraordinarily beautiful, well-preserved museum standard of a White House that's home to the president and his family, an office to the president and his staff, ceremonial stage upon which we receive our most important visitors, and a museum, it would not be the way that we enjoy it today. But many, many first ladies have contributed in significant ways over the years. That's just one example that's important to me. And part of our mission at the White House Historical Association has been one of education and of research, and research into our first ladies, these powerful and influential women who have in many cases, most cases, all cases, have made the men who they represent as the spouse to the President of the United States. Well, it's in that spirit that we were thrilled when we heard about a research project by an organization that has an extraordinary little acronym, FLAIR. You may have seen people walking around with, in fact, I should have worn my lapel pin that you gifted me. It's the First Ladies Association for Research and Education. And you all know that just this week on Monday, the brand new first ever textbook was released on First Ladies, titled U.S. First Ladies, Making History and Leaving Legacies. Later this year, a popular book, a trade book, will come out on the same topic. But for the first time, there is a text that's going to be available at colleges and universities to lead and train and share these stories about these wonderful women who have helped make our country what it is today. Well, we have an extraordinary final panel. As I said, we've saved the best for last. The moderator is the fantastic Dr. Barbara Perry, who is the Gerald L. Baliles Professor and co-chair of Presidential Oral History Program at the University of Virginia's Miller Center. She currently serves on the board of directors of the White House Historical Association, and she will be succeeding Anita McBride on our board as the chair of our Education Committee of the board, so we're honored and thrilled that we will have her leadership in that capacity next year. Joining her on stage are our three panelists who are actually the co-authors of this extraordinary book. Diana Carlin is Professor Emerita of Communications at St. Louis University. Anita McBride, that name sounds familiar to me, I don't know where. Anita McBride is chair of this wonderful Presidential Sites Summit. So Anita, thank you for your leadership on the Presidential Sites Summit. And she's also a board member of the White House Historical Association and has a wonderful platform and portfolio at American University focusing on many of these same issues. And Nancy Kegan Smith, former director of the Presidential Materials Division at the National Archives and Records Administration. Tomorrow, the day after the summit ends, because I know you will not have had enough of all of this, we are releasing a an episode of my podcast, The White House 1600 Sessions, that I recorded with Anita on this book on behalf of the three authors. And we recorded at the Dolly Madison House on Lafayette Square, which has been recently refurbished. And you'll see some of that in the video of that podcast that is released tomorrow. So enough from me, and on to the ladies to talk about the first ladies, our extraordinary panel.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stewart, so much. And as I always say, thank you for your leadership of the White House Historical Association. I'm really fortunate to be a part now of a number of boards and organizations, nonprofits that are related to my main passions in life as well as my career, and that is the presidency, the Supreme Court, the Kennedys, the Kennedy Library, et cetera. And Stewart and his leadership are paramount, it just seems to me. And of course, to Anita for putting together this project, a summit. You can imagine how much work goes into it.
Everybody, it's a team effort.
And along with everyone at the White House Historical Association. And I did want to do a little quick shout out for Grace McCaffrey because she led our panel. So let's. She literally led us on to stage. And a quick shout out and hello to Cindy Seide Buck, the daughter of Hugh Seide. Many of you might remember him as a wonderful correspondent at the White House who covered many presidents and wrote for Time Magazine. And it was amazing author. And I read his work as a grade schooler, already interested in this topic. And Cindy is in the development office at the White House Historical Association, and she couldn't be with us today. So I hope that she's able to watch and know that we're thinking about her. So congratulations are due to these three ladies who have allowed me to sneak in a little bit to their trio to become a quartet of women who are really interested in first ladies. But they have, unlike me, a newbie, I just started into this field really just about 20 years ago. Yeah. And they've been at it for somewhat longer than that because they have worked with and for first ladies, studied first ladies. They are the experts. And first of all, congratulations on this book. Anita, hold it up so that everyone knows it's available in the White House Historical Association shop here. And I understand that it's going to be raffled off and will be signed
by... This is the raffled one that will
be signed by each of the authors and co-authors. So be sure to stay, because if you're not here, you can't win. Now, why has it taken so long for a textbook, a college-level textbook, to be done on first ladies? As Stewart said, they've been around since Martha Washington. Right. So why it's taken so long?
Well,
let's have Diana.
I started teaching a course on first ladies over 30 years ago at the University of Kansas. And it sort of happened by accident because I was teaching a course on women in politics, and I wanted to go all the way back to the 17th century, to Anne Hutchinson. I wanted to provide sort of the context for women coming into the public sphere. And Abigail Adams' quotation was one I read as a child when I was reading women's biographies and included Abigail. And I realized these first ladies were the among our first women political activists, but in quiet ways. And so I began teaching a unit in this course on women in politics, which then evolved into a full-scale course. But there weren't that many at the time, and as we know, it's been hard to get these women's histories out there. Mm-hmm. It's happened more since 1982 and 1884, but it's been a smattering, and it's a niche area, so it's hard to get a textbook published in a niche area, which isn't gonna have 1,000 kids in a biology classroom. Mm-hmm. It's just a tougher kind of thing to do. Mm-hmm. And because it is a smaller number of classes, that's been, I think, part of the reason for it.
Right. Nancy, your thoughts?
My thought is I totally agree with my sisters. I think of Anita and Diana as sisters. I also think that we all know that history was very male-centric. And for a long time, I started work at the Johnson Library in August of 1973 and had the privilege of working with Mrs. Johnson. And for a long time, scholars thought of first ladies as just the spouse to the president. They really did not see them as an individual in their own right. And that began to change when in 1984, Betty Ford did a conference at Grand Rapids, Michigan, and a very eminent professor, Dr. Lewis Gould, took up the study of first ladies and made a very important argument that these women were accomplishing really important things and sometimes more important, leaving more important legacies, long-term legacies than their husbands. So it really started springboarding in the 1980s time period. But until then, first ladies studying them, it's very interesting, and then I'll stop. Dr. Gould, who I knew quite well, was asked why he was writing a book on Lady Bird Johnson and the environment. And he told me, Nancy, I had to justify it in the foreword because all his male scholars were saying, you know, that's sort of a feminine topic. And he said, I'm writing a book on Lady Bird Johnson and the environment because I believe her work in that area was as substantive, if not more substantive, than any man's. And he said, she deserves a book on this topic. Very interesting, to this day, there are very few books done on first ladies and subject matters. Barbara has done one mm-hmm. on the New Frontier, Lou Gould, on Lady Bird Johnson's environment, but most are biographies. But now I'll stop.
Yeah. Well, just to say about Lou Gould, we call him really the father of First Lady's studies, and thank goodness he was open-minded enough as a man, but also as a historian, when his own, perhaps, male colleagues mm-hmm. were saying that's not really a topic that we do in the history field. But he also, many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with, and probably some of you have written in this series that he launched with the mm-hmm. University Press of Kansas on modern first ladies. And he dated that from Mrs. McKinley onward. So from the beginning of the 20th century onward, there is a book that focuses on the first ladyship, not full biography, but biographical chapter at the beginning and what the First Lady did after her time in the White House. But it's such a contribution. And now to the textbook where you can see in one volume and more than simply an encyclopedic version, which Lou Gould did, of First Lady. So there are entries about them. But this is a thematic book as well as a biographical book. So Anita, if I could turn to you, and particularly the topic that really informs this whole summit of change and continuity, Nancy reminded me that's really, if you look at their book, is part of the thematic essence of it. So talk a little bit about that and also how the book is organized.
Well, the book is, or thank you, Barbara, and thank you to Nancy and Diana for just teeing this up so perfectly as to why there is a textbook. The time has come for it to be in every classroom, to be used at all of your presidential sites, and to really dive deeper into the role that first ladies have played throughout our history, the things that connect them from Martha Washington to Jill Biden. For example, by virtue of being wife of the commander in chief, they are all have cared about our veterans, our military families. From Martha Washington worrying about the Revolutionary War soldiers to Dr. Jill Biden and continuing the Joining Forces Initiative. There's a great example of continuity. But over the period of our history, their role, their ability to be visible, their ability to be public advocates of issues, of social issues, of things that they have cared about, has evolved as the country has evolved, and as women's place in society has evolved. And you've heard that today on the Women's History panel, how well that was described by our panelists from the Lincoln Library and from the Eleanor Roosevelt Valkill, about telling the context of the period of time in which
they lived and led their lives privately, but also in public roles, and how they were able to leverage that platform. So that's the change part. You know, this is the way we have organized this book, a lot by theme. Some, there's biographical data, of course, but it's, they are not biographies. They're thematic chapters, first ladies and their communications, first ladies and political activism, first ladies on the global stage, first ladies in policy issues, and overlaid with what was going on in the country at the time and how they played a role. And that's what, you know, the sites have an opportunity, have an obligation, have a challenge to help tell those stories as well. And that's how we've organized our book. Mm-hmm. And I think just one thing, if I could add to why we did the book, you know, Diana was approached, I mean, as a professor, she's written books. Diana's written books too. But Diana was approached by an academic publisher in California, Cognella, about writing a book. And this is after FLAIR was announced. FLAIR is a new organization, launched in 2021 in affiliation with American University, to which we're very, very grateful for their support. And that got the attention of the publisher as well. We had written an article together, the three of us, for CNN.com on First Ladies and Civil Rights, another issue in following the evolution of activism on civil rights, and that got attention. So when she was approached about a book, you know, she knew the gap in academic literature, and said the textbook, she recommended the textbook to them, and they wanted to do it, and the three of us joined forces, and it's been, I've never written a book. I've written a lot of chapters, I've written a lot of articles, but this was an incredible undertaking, and the editing process was torture. I was warned about that, but it was true. But I learned so much, and learned so much about First Ladies, learned so much from the two of them. I'm a practitioner, I'm not a scholar, I'm not a historian. I have a platform at American University that they gave me 10 years ago to launch a series of conferences around First Ladies, recognizing, they recognize as the only academic institution in the country that has an initiative dedicated to First Ladies, they recognize the growing influence, the advocacy, the public role. So that's given us a platform to not doing what we're doing, and we're really thrilled about that.
And I think I should add, we've actually written three books.
Yes.
We did a preliminary version. One of the things that Cognella, the publisher, requires is that you do a preliminary version of the book, which we did, and they basically take your Word document, they kind of make it look nice, they slap a cover on it and put preliminary, and then they ask you to teach from it. So a year ago, we tested it in five different classes. Mm-hmm. I taught a virtual class at American as part of this project, mm-hmm. And Lily Denman, who now works for the White House Historical Association, was one of my students. Matt Costello used part of the book in one of his classes at American. Up there in the upper stratosphere, Chris Leahy, who was at Keoka College, took parts of it and tested it at his college. And then I taught a class at St. Louis University and had a group of students at the University of Kansas, where I used to teach, who also worked on it. So we had five different groups of students who then gave us feedback, mm-hmm. and we revised it. And in fact, the students at St. Louis came up with the title.
Mm-hmm.
They said, you know, this title you have is kind of boring, and they were right. And they said, you know, this is really about the fact that these women made history and they left legacies. Mm-hmm. And so they said, here's what you ought to call it.
And we did.
So I really, you know, want to give a shout out to everybody who helped us and all these students. And then we rewrote it, and that's what this is. And now we are wrapping up the trade version, which is very different because all the pedagogical pieces are gone. We still are setting the historical context, but we've taken some chapters out that were, you know, how to do research in political and presidential libraries and various primary sources. Mm-hmm. So it enabled us to broaden what we were saying about a lot of the first ladies. So they're very different books because the audiences are very different. Mm-hmm.
But it's been three books.
And those of you who are authors and teachers and professors and know about books and read books know how unusual it is for a publisher to say, oh, let's turn your textbook into a trade book for the general audience. And then, again, the process that you had to go through to do that. I do want to come back to the, I'll call it beta testing of the book with students. In addition to their suggestion of titles, what did they say they wanted from this book? What did they want in it? And did you notice, if you were able to determine genders, did you notice anything different between female students, male students, or perhaps even non-binary students?
Well, I think that the feedback we got from the male students, and Christopher can attest, when he tested it in his classes, why didn't we know this?
Right, yeah.
Why haven't we heard these stories before? Mm-hmm. They're so important. Mm-hmm. They've made important contributions. We do a chapter on civil rights. Some of these first ladies led the way in civil rights and social rights. And they wanted to know why they had not heard about that. Another fun thing we got is Diana would nicely have Anita and me to talk with her classes. And so I'm talking with one of the classes, and they're saying, this book is so interesting, it's not like a normal textbook. Well, I'm not a professor, you know, so I'm more like Anita. And so I say, well, why is it not like a normal textbook? And they go, because it's fascinating. It's not boring.
It's not boring.
And then we said, well, would Cognella, our textbook company, like that?
But... yeah, but the other thing, that they really liked the fact we'd humanized these women, and we've heard that on so many panels. These were humans. I mean, we showed their foibles. We showed that they'd had tragedies in their lives, and that these tragedies affected what they did, and that they've affected, like, especially in the case of Mary Lincoln, the way that she's been portrayed in history. Mm-hmm. And so they loved the human piece of it. One of my husband's favorite stories, and he was one of my little editors out there, history major, was that we also bring in other materials. And Heath Lee, who's writing the Pat Nixon story, did a White House Historical Association program on the Nixon letters. And I had the class watch that, because one of the things we've done in the book is we've had them link, and we have an e-version so they can easily link to some of our FLAIR programs, to White House Historical, to others. And so they found out that Richard Nixon would drive Pat Nixon, before they were married, to dates, because he wasn't going to give up on her, even if she was dating it. And they just thought that was the most romantic thing they'd ever heard. And they loved those kinds of stories, but they had never really thought about what these women had done before, that many of them had taught their husbands public speaking, like Andrew Johnson's wife did, you know, and that they were better educated in some ways, and that they had a life before they became a first lady. So that was one of the things they wanted more of. We needed a little more historical context in some places because they are ahistorical. And we did set up the book to do a contextual piece beforehand, saying here was what was going on during this time. And you know, Watergate, we were talking about this at lunch, they didn't really know what Watergate was, so we had to explain it. So those were the kinds of things. I don't know if you can remember anything else.
No, absolutely.
Well, so I have to just bear down on, are you saying Richard Nixon drove Pat, his future wife, to dates with other men?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yes.
Yes. Poor Richard Nixon. But he won in the end, right?
He won.
He won Pat's heart.
Well, and they were fascinated that Lyndon Johnson had a very quick romance with Lady Bird. He basically decided the first time he met her he wanted to marry her. She thought he was kidding, joking. But he wasn't kidding and joking. And so they start letter writing, and she goes, she's very, Mrs. Johnson's cautious, and she goes, Lyndon, I don't know what the deal is, but I'm afraid it might be politics. And the students like that, but it is so similar to the way Jackie Kennedy felt about politics and the way Michelle Obama when Obama was running for the state Senate, she said, are you crazy? We have student loans, you know, so they could see the similarities and the differences mm-hmm. between different first ladies. Some first ladies pushed their husbands into the job. Mm-hmm. Some had no desire for their husbands to be in the job. But as Diana says, and Anita, we really tried to humanize them, make their story relatable, and most of all, feature their importance. Right. And they so deserve their place mm-hmm. in history.
So it occurs to me then that this really is the best wrap-up panel, because one of the themes that we've been having is how to tell history in an interesting way. Mm-hmm. And you have just explained that this book does that, and you all are doing it as you're out speaking and teaching. And the other is not only that this is a way to teach about individuals and tell their interesting individual stories, which makes history interesting, but it also, you said when the students required more context, because what mm-hmm. many of us lived through is history, mm-hmm. and sometimes ancient history for younger people, it's a great way to teach civics, isn't
yes.
it?
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
So that not just that. History, not just biography, not just, for me, political science, but a wonderful way, and just imagine how, even though we say this is a college text, mm-hmm. but that it could be used, I'm sure, in many levels.
Grade school, middle school. History classes,
without
definitely.
A doubt.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So we should do for Gilder Lehrman, you know, yeah. we should offer yeah. A course yeah. because they have, many of you may know about this, but I will tell you about it just very quickly. So Gilder Lehrman has a master's degree program that only costs $10,000, 10 courses now being run through Gettysburg College. So you you get your credits through them and you get your degree. It is for teachers, for National Park Service, personnel and rangers, and for museum curators. So anyone out in our audience today or anyone you know who's okay. looking to make that next advancement
really?
In career, please do look into it. And I yeah. teach courses for them. It's all online. So I'm thinking you all should do one for them. Well, on First
I'd Lady. Like to add right. one thing to that as you're talking. It's just a reminder, too, about our publisher and how flexible they are with how this book yes. can be used. Because you don't have to buy, as a student or at the library, the school, the whole book. We can curate chapters that are adapted to. If it's a women's studies program, but if you want certain chapters, out of that, if it's a communications class, you know, our chapters on First Ladies and their rhetoric, or the convention speeches and their political campaigning, or political science classes. So it can be adapted to different courses. So for any of you affiliated with universities, I don't have to worry about AU because they've already adopted this twice. But if you're affiliated with other universities, please encourage them to look at this. We have cards here with the QR code, and the libraries, the schools, the deans of departments can look into getting this textbook or curated versions electronically online, or you know, the hard copy if they want the whole thing. That has been yeah. really right, and you
it,
would know how different that is.
It was one of the
that
things
is.
That was very attractive when they approached me about, do you want to, they had talked to me several years before, but I was an associate provost working 60 hours a week, and I said, I don't have time to write a book. Mm-hmm. And then I got this email exactly 3 years ago this month yeah. saying, do you have an idea for a book? And I really wanted to do this one because we had just formed Flair, and mm-hmm. Nancy and Anita and I had just written the CNN, so I knew we could write well together. And so I pitched it, but I pitched one other book, and they jumped on this one. And so, you know, I liked the fact that you could curate because we wanted it to be interdisciplinary. I think the thing that's exciting about First Lady Studies and about the book is that you can use this book. I come out of communication, I'm political communication. You can use it in a communication class, you can use it in women's studies, because we talk about women's roles in this society from the 18th century on, and where suffrage fits in, where the temperance movement came in, and how that affected the husband's politics, which then affected what the wives could do. So it can be used in a history class, it can be used in political science. but you may not want the whole thing. And like Matt curated it for what he does with his class on White House history. Mm-hmm. And Chris was doing early American history, and so he had it curated. So I really liked that about the publisher, and that was, I think, one of the mm-hmm. things we really found attractive. And we wrote the book in a way that you can do that easily.
Mm-hmm. So I would bet you too that in the communications realm, mm-hmm. that for, I heard someone mention today, teachers have to be certain they're teaching math and language arts, particularly in high school and middle school. So I would bet the communications component could be used by teachers teach language arts in the slightly lower, higher ed. Yeah. Nancy?
Well, we were amazed. Before we did the book, we did a program for the National Archives Foundation on First Ladies and Civil Rights. Mm-hmm. And I would call to see, I'm always interested in how many people have signed up, and I remember dealing with their person who controls numbers, and she goes, Nancy, we're at 950. If we go bigger, we're gonna have to switch to a different platform to do the program. Now that is just an amazing figure for one program, and I bring it up because it shows you that the three of us weren't wrong. There's a niche for this field. It's been a long time coming. But these women on civil rights, Eleanor was much more liberal on civil rights than FDR. Mm-hmm. And she could do things, frankly, that he couldn't do, and then he could say, that was my missus doing it. You know, he had plausible deniability, but in another way, he sort of liked Eleanor doing it. Or Mrs. Johnson, you know, doing civil rights, the amazing things. And so we were so impressed by, and also it crossed by, it was bipartisan. In other words, it wasn't just Democratic first ladies who did civil rights, it was Democratic, Republican. It humanizes them, their interests, mm-hmm. their desires, and they all have an incredible sense of history and an incredible sense of wanting to improve people's lives.
And pick up on that. We had to make some decisions on the organization of this. I mean, we wanted to introduce all of the first ladies. Dr. Biden gave us an interview mm-hmm. For the chapter on the baby boomer first ladies. So like I said, even some of the first ladies we divided mm-hmm. up somewhat thematically because they were affected by the times in which they grew up. And that affected a lot of what they did. But we had this civil rights article that we'd written, and then we did the archives program that summer. Mm-hmm. And we knew that was a very important topic, and we decided to put it as a second chapter in the book. And part of the reason we did that was that one of the points we make in the first chapter is what Anita talked about, change and continuity, that there are issues that have affected first ladies from Martha Washington on. Mm-hmm. And our slavery history, plus where we've gone with civil rights, to then having an African-American first lady. This was all an important part of our history, and we thought that needed to be up front as an example of this thread mm-hmm. and how all of these social issues and political issues and human issues came together. And the students get it. They say, whoa, yeah, we hadn't really thought about this in this way, because you see the entire arc of that history mm-hmm. in this chapter. And I have to give another shout out because the White House Historical Association, Slavery in the President's Neighborhood, was important piece
Absolutely.
Of what we cover in that chapter.
Inspired by a First Lady's words, Mrs. Obama.
Exactly, by Michelle Obama's speech. And they also said that they liked that chapter because we talk about the slave owners mm-hmm. who brought their enslaved servants to the White House. Mm-hmm. And that was certainly a political statement that was being made by those 10 families. Mm-hmm. And the Washingtons own a judge who ran away and they tried to get her back. And they were saying, we've seen the foibles. We see that these women weren't perfect but yet you had to look at it within the context of the times.
Mm-hmm. And their background.
And their backgrounds, and all of that's in there. So there was a lot of thought given mm-hmm. And Anita, you might want to talk about the chapter we inserted before we got to the World War II wives about the East Wing.
Oh, about the forming of the East Wing. Yeah, that was a chapter that we had on this. The creation of the office of First Lady. This was not a given for First Lady to have an office, to have a staff. Again, of course, the first number of families brought their slaves to the White House and they tended to them. But when you're moving into the modern world, and we talked about last night at the session with social secretaries, the first professional staff member for a First Lady is a social secretary, Isabella Hagner, to handle the growing pressure of the social obligations that the First Lady had, and then managing that with a big family. So here you start to professionalize the staff, and that grew over time with press relations, an assistant for press relations that Jackie Kennedy had hired. Then Lady Bird Johnson really professionalized that even further by creating a staff director role and brought a professional press journalist as her press secretary. But it really wasn't until Mrs. Carter, who really was the driving force behind a formalized office of First Lady. And then the staff began, she actually had the first office director, which I'm grateful to, because that's the precursor to the chief of staff, which is the role I had, of course, for Laura Bush, who gave me a front row seat to history to see just how incredibly impactful that this role is and how much a First Lady can do and that they do. And she, had a staff that supported, her with speechwriters and with schedulers, and one of her junior schedulers is here now working for Boeing. And thank you for your support of the summit. But again, we have to thank Mrs. Carter and here's what's so interesting about that, how she was able to formalize an Office of First Lady. The White House Personnel Authorization Act was passed in 1978. The first budget was actually given to an office of the First Lady. The staff all had to be considered staff of the president assigned to the First Lady, because of course they're not the elected official. But she's doing all this because her husband wanted her to chair the Mental Health Commission. She wanted to do all this work and be very engaged, but he also campaigned on cutting the White House staff. So how do you marry those two things, together? But somehow it has prevailed, and actually staff of First Lady has continued to grow. It's in the, the numbers now that has stayed pretty average, 20 or so. Yeah. But it takes, a lot of people to help support the First Lady. But here is what every First Lady, at least that I've come to know, and the one that I've worked for, who said to me when I interviewed for the job as Chief of Staff, "I'm not here for me. I'm here for George and because of George." And really, throughout history, these First Ladies took on issues, took on things that mattered to them. They were best at it when they took on topics that they cared about, had some background in. But they did it. They were the primary person who cared most about the success of their husbands' presidencies. And that is a thread of connectivity for these women.
I would say to that, it's such a similar comment to what Lady Bird, who I was privileged to know and work with, said to me. I was there to support Lyndon. Lyndon supported me, and this is very interesting. Lyndon supported me in whatever I wanted to do. Lady Bird wanted to do Whistle Stop. There's a common misimpression of her going down to the South because Lyndon Johnson asked her to do that. No, Lyndon Johnson did not ask her to do it. He supported Lady Bird, Liz, and Bess Sable in arranging that train trip to go down to the South. And Mrs. Johnson said he was always supportive. He supported me in beautification, but he never fixed my agenda mm-hmm. because Lyndon knew I would pick things mm-hmm. that supported mm-hmm. his agenda. Mm-hmm. And so part of what a First Lady achieves, of course, is how empowered she is by her husband.
Definitely.
And so that too, you know, some First Ladies are, some First Ladies aren't, but Lady Bird made the really important comment that a First Lady, you know, it's a job with no rules, no rule books. Who is the First Lady elected by? She's elected by one person. Mm-hmm. And that is really, in the final analysis, where the base of her power is. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that really brings me to another question before we get into some of your stories about, and you've begun down that road a bit, about First Ladies you have known, mm-hmm. worked with, interviewed in person. But on that note, particularly for those of us who study most recently Hillary Rodham Clinton, and the Miller Center is doing, and my colleague Sheila Blackford is here, mm-hmm. Is the co-director with Alita Black of the Miller Center's project to interview Hillary as well as those she worked with, particularly at the State Department. So it's really not so much about her first ladyship, although they're asking her about that, but they also want it to be about how she came with her agenda to the State Department. So what happens, particularly with first ladies like that, first ladies like Eleanor Roosevelt? The good news is they're not elected. And the reason that's good news is they can go down these roads that their mm-hmm. husbands say, okay, that's okay for you to do, but not necessarily I can't do it or don't want to do it or don't have time or don't even necessarily have the interest or the background that that first lady has. So the good news is she's given in some ways a wide berth, but with guardrails, because the American people, here's the bad news, mm-hmm. know that this person is not accountable mm-hmm. to them.
That's right.
Because they're not accountable to the electorate. Mm-hmm. And so the American people have an interesting way of letting first ladies know that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so what did you find in your study across all of history of first ladies about that?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's an interesting balance. You know, they can only go so far. Eleanor went pretty far, and actually FDR supported her. And Hillary was supported by Bill, mm-hmm. but definitely the three of us would say was an example of someone on the healthcare task force. I think it was two things. She went too far, and the issue was not at the right time. I mean, it was before.
I think
its
it was
time.
Right. It was not at maybe the right time for the country. The issue was certainly one she was deeply steeped in the background and the knowledge, and as you say, Nancy, the president wanted her to do, and we fairly, you know, discussed that. But to your point, Barbara, was the country ready for that model of first lady that pushed the guardrails out really far? And they weren't, but to her credit, she pivoted mm-hmm. To what she could do and right. has really had enormous impact and is what she took with her mm-hmm. to the State Department and set up standards, you know, for how women are, you know, integrated into our foreign policy that had not been that deep before, including when foreign delegations would come to meet with her at the State Department. There are some, including Afghanistan, she refused to meet with unless women were in the delegation. So that's something, like in your new project, I'm sure, you know, will come out. But that's the point, they could pivot. If it didn't work, first they pivoted to something else and didn't want to waste this privilege and opportunity that they had as first ladies.
And so went back to something a little more traditional for first ladies in the case
right.
of Hillary, pivoting to women
and mm-hmm.
children
yes.
families,
yep. right.
And goes to Beijing and right. says to right. the world, you know, human rights are women's rights are human rights. Mm-hmm. And we think of, I think, modern and contemporary first ladies as picking a topic, sometimes a topic. You mentioned Rosalind Carter and mental health. Mm-hmm. when did that start? Is that something that we should know more about that started earlier than we think with contemporary First Ladies?
Well, we address that because we do think it's something the modern First Ladies have done. But it really goes back to Martha, because Martha chose the veterans. I mean, she didn't turn anyone away. She was giving personal money. She even asked George to use his power of pardon to get some veterans off of, you know, minor little infractions who were going to be doing some time in jail, and their wives would come to her. But she really attended. She wrote personal checks. We had a lot of other First Ladies who orphans. Dolly Madison supported an orphanage. Caroline Harrison, who people don't know a whole lot about, but was an amazing woman, she was being asked to be a patron for Johns Hopkins. Right. And she said she would only help them raise money, she believed in what they were doing, if they admitted women to medical school. Mm-hmm. So they did. And so, you know, here's an example of someone who's doing something. We, you know, we had other First Ladies who were, you know, Mary Lincoln, was doing a lot, once again, with, it was mentioned this morning, the contrabands. Mm-hmm. That was a cause Mary Lincoln was very much devoted to. But I think what's happened is that they've been asked more by the media to identify what their cause is, and it gets a lot of publicity. But it's something that they have all done with their charitable work, with the things, once again, they're passionate about. And, you know, Ida McKinley, you know, had some health problems, and this is another kind of thread, which shows how many of these women had health problems while they were there, and how they still were able to. She knitted socks, and used those as sort of charitable types of things too, and so it's something that really goes clear back to Martha, but in the modern era, there is that identification, and then they end up with something like what Barbara Bush has done, or many of the others, the foundations, and we talk about that in the book, which is a huge part of their legacy.
And I think with Eleanor, you of course start with your modern activist model. And it's interesting, Eleanor, scholars really don't view Eleanor as picking one project because Eleanor was so out there on so many issues. And so it sort of evolves. Mrs. Johnson clearly delineated projects, Mrs. Kennedy, White House Restoration, Mrs. Johnson, Head Start, Beautification, and Civil Rights. And then there becomes sort of a desire. Mrs. Nixon followed with volunteerism. They tend to refine and define for the press specific projects. But I loved it because in doing Eleanor, you sort of think as a First Lady scholar, well, Eleanor starts everything. But Eleanor did not start the defining of projects because Eleanor's world was so big that Eleanor went wherever Eleanor wanted to go.
Well, and that was the other thing. I think another thing that changed was when women got the right to vote with the 19th Amendment in 1920. Now, there were several states that were giving women the right, full voting rights before that, but 1920 is really the landmark piece. So then you can begin to have women talking more about political issues because they're actually at the polling place. And so you now have Lou Henry Hoover, who's taking advantage also of technology with radio. And she had a studio in the White House where she practiced her radio addresses. And Lou Henry Hoover was the first First Lady to actually give a speech. And she gave it on the radio. And she gave multiple speeches, especially during the Depression, to the women of the country. And this gets back to women staying in their lane, where, you know, she's giving advice on economizing and how to make do during this tough time. So she sort of set a stage for Eleanor to begin then doing more with public media and giving speeches. Because up until Lou Henry, none of the First Ladies had really given a formal speech.
It made it tough for people who followed.
That was good. As always, we're on the same page, Anita. Yeah. This makes me think, is it more than coincidental that if we look at the First Ladies who followed directly after more activist First Ladies, so let's take Bess Truman right. and Mamie Eisenhower, but particularly Bess Truman after Eleanor mm-hmm. and Mrs. Laura Bush mm-hmm. After Mrs. Clinton. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's more than coincidental in the sense that it was coincidental that those happened to be two first ladies who weren't as activist as their predecessor, or do they actively say, you know, we see some pushback, maybe we better pull
back? No, I think that they wanted to be themselves. I think that, you know, Bess Truman, and we do a chapter on this, stepping back from activism, but it's Bess Truman, Mamie Eisenhower are included in that. But for Mrs. Truman, you know, she came into this role, first of all, it's the last thing in the world she wanted, and it was after, of course, the tragic death of Franklin Roosevelt. She didn't want to be in the public eye. She didn't want the personal and tragic story of her own family, that her father had committed suicide, to be at risk of coming out publicly. So, but that doesn't mean she wasn't influential. She was incredibly influential with her husband. She was a Senate staffer for him. She did his scheduling, his correspondence, helped with speeches. So she helped it make it politically possible for him to even run for office back in Missouri. But by the time she became First Lady, this is, you know, a woman who was at the stage of her life, she knew who she was. And as she said, I don't have to go down in any coal mines. She wasn't going to be Eleanor. So that was a choice, you know, that she made. But it's still her, too, you know, found the niche in the way that she could be the First Lady that she wanted to be.
And didn't she stay quite often back in Missouri?
Yes, right.
Back in Missouri, because I can remember hearing about Harry Truman's many letters to her. Sure. Talk about someone who was besotted for mm-hmm. his whole marriage right. with right. his wife. How wonderful. Right. And that he would write these sad letters from the White House, you know, dear Bess.
When she went home.
I wish you were here. I feel like something the cat dragged in. I'm so lonely. But that was part of her knowing herself and knowing what she wanted her role to be.
And that her mother, you know, was living with them at the White House, was not really happy being there, so was happier at home in Missouri. So she was, you know, juggling both of these things. And the Truman family, the three of them were a unit, you know, husband, wife, and daughter. But Mrs. Truman was incredibly influential. I'm just gonna say one thing, given that this is hosted by the White House Historical Association, we really all have Bess Truman to thank, that the structure, the exterior structure that we look at the White House was really, she was a champion for preserving that. Because remember, when they were living there, the White House for 3.5 years was, they did not live there because it was uninhabitable. It had to be completely rebuilt. It was structurally unsound. You know, the options for rebuilding the White House were in front of the Congress, and one of the options to be funded, and one of the options, which was the cheapest option, was to tear the whole thing down and start over. Well, her background is having worked in on the Hill. She knew a little bit about lobbying and advocating, and really pressed quietly behind the scenes with appropriators in the Senate, with the spouses, those appropriators, to say, if you do this, the American people will never forgive you. So when we think of preservation of the White House, we rightfully, of course, think of Jackie Kennedy and the gold standard that she set of preservation. We have to get a lot of credit to Bess Truman, too, who had a great deal to do with what we look at in the north.
If you haven't
south
seen that
sides.
Picture of the bulldozer inside
yes.
the
it's
walls,
in our book.
It's in the book.
It's in
it. Yes, it is. My mother bought for me the American Heritage Book of Presidents when I was in mm-hmm. high school, and that picture is in the section on
yes.
the Trumans. So I loved it. What would you say about Laura Bush?
Yeah, I was going to say, I know.
Mrs.
I have
Clinton,
to give rightful
Secretary.
Due to the person I, of course, worked with the closest as First Lady. This is. Mrs. Bush, again, was very comfortable in her own skin. She knows who she is. She's grounded. She's one of the most solid people to have been in that position. She didn't have to be something someone else wanted her to be. And she was very active as First Lady of Texas. She brought those issues with her to the White House. But this is how, imagine coming into this role, and one of the first questions you get by a reporter when your husband has just been elected. So, Mrs. Bush, who are you going to be? You're going to be more like Barbara Bush or Hillary Clinton? Think about that. And she said, well, I know Laura Bush pretty well. I'm going to be her. and again, the stereotype right at the beginning, your mother, and you're going to be more like your mother-in-law, sort of a woman of the World War II age, traditional, even though Barbara Bush, she spoke her mind. Let's not kid ourselves. Or are you going to be the activist model of Hillary Clinton? Well, she's going to be her. And she was an extraordinarily successful first lady for eight years. She picked her issues, and she dove deep and left as a very popular first lady. And again, one of our first ladies in history who are sometimes, often, more popular than their husbands.
Yes, that is true. Nancy, we're getting close to our question time, so please begin to approach the microphones with your questions. And while you're doing that, Nancy.
I would like to springboard off of what Anita said, because, of course, Lady Bird came in to being First Lady in an absolutely awful way, with the assassination, being in the motorcade, seeing it, talking to Mrs. Kennedy about her bloody dress, and being such a wonderful person. And I think one of the things that I am so appreciative of my career is the privilege of having worked with and known Lady Bird Johnson. But she comes in, and just like with Laura Bush, I mean, you have the Jackie Kennedy comparison. And Jackie Kennedy is East Coast, aristocratic. Mrs. Johnson was not from a poor family, but she is definitely Southwest Texas. And Mrs. Johnson loved issues, and she didn't care a whole lot about fashion. You know, Lyndon cared about fashion and tried to be. She would call Lyndon Harry Higgins. You know, he would tell her to wear this dress or that. But she comes in, and interestingly enough, Jackie Kennedy, 3 days after the assassination, invites Mrs. Johnson to a tea. And Mrs. Johnson told me the story, and she says, Lady Bird, it's really important to me that White House preservation continues and be made permanent. And Jackie Kennedy, and this is in light, you know, her husband's been assassinated 3 days earlier, has done a 6-page handwritten letter, which she has also gotten Clark Clifford, a lawyer, to show how the Johnsons can set up a permanent committee to make the committee that Jackie Kennedy had more permanent. And she asked Mrs. Johnson to please continue the White House restoration effort. That is the only instance I know of where a first lady asked another first lady to continue on with her love. And so Mrs. Johnson did. Lyndon Johnson passed an executive order in 1964 and formed the Committee for the Preservation of the White House, which every first lady from Lady Bird forward has headed up, and White House restoration became a permanent part, and the White House curator became a permanent part of the White House structure. But Lady Bird, you know, she liked to be out in the trees. She liked to be in digging dirt, and she took the news down on white rafts and helped some reporters who fell off, pulled them back in the boat. So these first ladies want to define themselves by themselves.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite, Nancy, one of my favorite stories about her role with, excuse me for interrupting, but her role with Lyndon was that tape, one of the recordings,
because
as you know, Lyndon Johnson recorded just about everything, meetings, phone calls, and that's another element that the Miller Center does is annotate those and transcribe those and put those online and put them out for students and teachers. But the one that I love of Lady Bird is after, it was a news conference, was it?
It's a news conference.
Yes, Diana, in your communication.
And
she gives him a review, instant analysis. But tell what she said to him.
He had great trouble with the press. Mrs. Johnson had managed a radio station, had Liz Carpenter, a professional journalist, as her press secretary, and she was very press savvy. So Lyndon was having trouble projecting an image in his press conferences, and Mrs. Johnson watched one. And she calls him up, and the operator says, Mrs. Johnson's on the line. This is after the press conference. Would you like to take the call? And he goes, Mrs. Johnson, and the press operator says yes. And he said yes. And so for about 3 to 4 minutes, she holds forth. You know, Lyndon, you need to be more direct. You need to look the press in the eye.
She told him how to breathe.
She told him how to breathe. She told him he was talking.
She said that she didn't feel he gave a truthful answer about when he was going to meet with the gall. And
she graded him.
Yes,
the grade. What was the grade?
B plus.
At best. He ends, Barbara, by saying, well, I think it was much, much better than that. You know, but he would depend. I mean, I am sure she is the only person in the world who could have done that to Lyndon Johnson. But he so trusted her, and she advised him on what he was going to say in the March 31st speech, and even how he would end it.
I love that part too, where you see in the video that Lady Bird and the two daughters, Lucy and Linda Bird, were there, and that they just all hug each other when he stands up after the March 31st speech, saying, I will not run. For another term as your president, hounded out of office by Vietnam and the student uprisings and civil rights and that sort of thing. So let's go to our first question. Leah, please.
Hi, thank you for being here today. I've really enjoyed your conversation. I don't know if anyone would have asked you this before, but we hear people ask often in the news, oh, are we ready for our first woman president? Yes, if you were wondering. but I'd like to ask the other side of that. From what you've said today and from what I understand about history, the role of the first lady, whatever they might be doing, they're acting in a way that's very traditionally feminine. It's very quiet, it's interpersonal, it's, you know, polite and behind the scenes almost. Mm-mm. Are we ready for our first male first dude?
Of course we are.
Sure.
And
sure,
what would that role look like, and how would it be different?
Pretty much the same.
I think it's just like we said with these women. Whoever it is will define it his way.
Yeah.
And we have plenty of models of that. I live in a state where we're on our third woman governor.
Yeah.
And each of the three men has been very different. And one of them was a federal judge, so he couldn't do anything. He was scot-free. Mm-hmm. But, you know, another one is a doctor. And she actually, you know, kind of relied on him during the pandemic a little bit. But they've all kind of done their own thing. And this goes back many years.
And I think, and Diana's absolutely right, we have models of this in our country at the state level. I mean, you look at the current Secretary of Commerce, Gina Raimondo, who, when she was governor of Rhode Island, her husband quit his job. He was a full-time dad. So he's comfortable with that. Why not?
And the second gentleman.
And we have the second gentleman now is not able to work as a lawyer, but is working as a teacher. So this is how I would answer this in short answer, is the country adapts to changes. And having worked in the White House three different times, I can honestly say the White House adapts to its occupants and the occupants adapt to the White House. It's part of the change and the evolution and how we continue to grow. It will be a great moment when we have a woman certainly sitting in the Oval Office, and if her spouse is a male spouse, he'll adapt to the role.
You know, and some of them may even choose to just step back from the role.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Thing is, it's a role without a rule book.
Mm-hmm.
And the American public expects a great deal from that role.
Mm-hmm.
And it is amazing. We say these men have picked incredibly well because they picked women who were willing to help them, to help them in their career, to go through all the hardships that these women did go through, but to still support their husbands. And it is an amazing list of women and support and love.
And that, to that point, that would be the number one priority for the spouse of any president, is to be that incredible support, the sanctuary behind the scenes, because there's no more pressure-filled job than being president of the United States. So that would be at the top of the list of a position.
And some of that is, we talked earlier in the conference about the pillow talk and how that might be if the president prefers to be talking politics upstairs in the residence and the first lady does, they will. Jackie Kennedy said straight out, my husband dealt with politics all day, and she said that was not my role for him. Though John Kenneth Galbraith said she had a fascinating and absolutely on-point understanding of the way he put it was who the smart people were and who the stupid people were. And so she would tell her husband, get with the smart people. So that
Mamie Eisenhower didn't want any work talk up in the residence either. That was the sanctuary when
the grants
were the same
Where they can just relax. Speaking of Mamie Eisenhower, I've visited Gettysburg, but I haven't known a lot about her. And I just read her granddaughter Susan Eisenhower's book, Mrs. Ike, that is based on diary entries, letters, but is really a full biography as well. So I highly recommend it if you haven't.
Great.
Our next question, please, and tell us who you are.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth. I am one of the White House Next Gen leaders, and I'm here on a Rubenstein Center fellowship. So I'm actually here working on the development of the East Wing staff for my PhD at Oxford in the UK. And I was actually going to ask Leah's question first. And I have a number of questions, but obviously I, like probably many people here, I'm gonna go and read the book. So I thought instead I would indulge in sort of taking the opportunity to ask you all who your favorite first ladies are and why, please.
So hard.
Or your favorite story.
That'd be great.
Oh, yes. Favorite story of first lady.
I have a favorite story. Do you want to go first?
It was sort of whichever one I was writing about at the time.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, Abigail Adams has always been one of my favorites, and that goes back to about the fourth grade when I started reading all these women's biographies. But Sarah Polk is one who I have come to really appreciate, and there's a great book called Lady First. I mean, she was incredibly powerful, but you know, I just have respect for all of them. I came to have far more respect or an understanding, I think, of everything Pat Nixon did under very difficult circumstances of a West Wing that was trying to keep her from being in the news. So I don't really have a favorite anymore. I've come to respect all of them.
That is such a great answer.
First lady, favorite story?
Oh.
Nancy?
Well, I have so many. I'm trying to think. Mrs. Johnson was such a class act. I guess this is sort of a funny story. Mrs. Johnson, who had a great deal of money, was extremely thrifty. And this is after the First Lady's years, and she is having, I'm going to get killed for telling this, but I'll tell it, Lady Jane Englehart to dinner at the ranch. And Lady Jane Englehart at the time was the richest woman in the world. Charles Englehart owned all the gold and diamond mines in South Africa. and I am with her secretary in her office I just happened to be in, and they're going over the lunch. And so she says, Lady Bird, Lady Jane likes asparagus. And Lady Bird goes, great, we'll get canned asparagus. We're both. No, you can't serve Lady Jane canned asparagus. And Lady Bird's going, why? And we go, you've got to serve fresh asparagus, you know.
So good spring for the fresh.
That's one funny story I have because, you know, it just struck us in your mind.
Well, thank you.
Can I add one to that? Because Diana sort of teed this up well. It's really hard to choose a favorite because there are so many stories I've uncovered in researching this. The one story I'll share that it just shows sort of the power behind the scenes, but it was a game changer, was Edith Roosevelt, you know, the back channel kind of diplomat that she was during the Russo-Japanese War, and that she had was a conduit to a British diplomat stationed in St. Petersburg, Russia, and who is passing these messages to her to give to her husband, so to give to the president. So it was bypassing some official channels and then protected from spies or being leaked. Well, we know what sits in the Roosevelt room of the White House is the Nobel Peace Prize for President Roosevelt and his negotiating successful, peaceful end to the Russo-Japanese War. But here, what's going to your point, behind the scenes, what's going on is his wife played an incredible role in helping him, but he gets the prize. But in my book, she gets a prize. She gets a prize too. Remarkable. But there's so many stories
there
like
are.
That.
We could do many, many more hours, and I wish definitely. We could, and we should.
Think
next
Tina
summit.
Has
do we
question.
Have another?
Yes. Tina Chen.
Hello.
Another, in addition to
Tina Chen from the Obama Foundation and the White House Historical Association.
And
congratulations
say what you did at the White House.
Sorry?
Say what you did at the White House, Tina.
Well, I was chief of staff to Mrs. Obama, among other things.
Among other things.
But one of the things I did not know until I took that job and actually started to interact with people overseas, and I'd like you to talk about this, is how unique we are in the United States in having first ladies like this and having first ladies staffed and supported in the way they are, and that it is a truly unlike anywhere else, including our cousins in the UK, where the prime minister's wife has a half of a staff person, and the other half of that person is funded by the party. So I wonder if you could talk about that and how unique that is and that evolution.
Yeah, we actually address that in the first chapter, and it goes back to the way we set up our government. We have one person who is both the head of state and the head of government. And so the head of state position is all of the diplomatic pieces, the state dinners, pardoning turkeys. You know, prime ministers don't do that in the UK. You know, the royal family do those kinds of things. So we've rolled this all into one. Mm-hmm. And as a result of that, starting with Martha, George knew that being head of state, he had to have a partner to do all of this because he's busy creating a whole government in the country. And so I think that it's just our governmental system. When you have a parliamentary system, you split those responsibilities. But the First Lady's becoming more important internationally. The George W. Bush has the international work that they do with First Ladies, and you know more.
And the First Ladies themselves overseas have sort of seen, as Tina knows, and I know exactly what you're speaking of, because we would arrive as the American First Lady in a foreign country on a solo trip, and we're in the big blue and white planes, not Air Force One, but they're, you know, planes that the First Lady has access to, and there's a full staff on board, there's some traveling press, there's Secret Service, and you're arriving in countries. I remember, in fact, Cherie Blair writes about this in her book, her memoirs after she left 10 Downing, was she was on a joint trip meeting Laura Bush in Africa. We were arriving in Rwanda after a G8 summit that was focused on Africa. Mrs. Blair arrives ahead of time, flies commercially, is picked up by a local, you know, embassy representative there, has a staff person assigned to her that's from the foreign ministry in the UK, not her own staff person, and her luggage is being, you know, shoved into the back of a hatchback car, and then here rolls in Laura Bush and her team, the chief of staff. Here I am coming down the stairs in the personal aid, and you know, press is coming off the back, and all the, you know, the military staff taking all of our bags down, and a group of SUVs to take us out. She writes about this in her book. And this is the UK. This is the wife of the Prime Minister of the UK, who was, she was a barrister, she was very active, but yet the staff support was just not there. And in all these countries in Africa where we were working with First Ladies, they all see themselves as the mothers of their country. They want to be involved, they want to be engaged. The culture was just not there to support First Ladies the same way. If they engaged in work or if they tried to establish foundations, really the culture in their countries questioned, how are you using your time? How are you using these resources? Is this money, is it going to help us? Is it going to help you? Are you going on shopping sprees? I mean, that was sort of the mentality around it. That is changing incredibly a lot. Mrs. Obama worked a lot with her counterparts around the seas. Dr. Biden is working with them. Laura Bush did. You're seeing in so many pockets around the country, particularly in Africa, so many more First Ladies have structured offices or have staffs. It's changing. It's changing. All around the world, the role of the First Lady, the role of the spouse of the president is seen as so much more integral to the work of the government than it ever has been before. I'd like to think we in our country have provided that example to people around the world, and where we can, we have helped them. I know you have, I know I have. And I want to say one last thing, because Tina's up here. Last night in our session, we showed a picture of the social secretaries and their club. The rest of us who work in the White House are very, very jealous of that all former social secretaries have a little club. Well, Tina Chen was the first person to, at the very end of the Obama administration, she called a bunch of former chiefs of staff to First Ladies and hosted us for the first little luncheon of, I wish I had the picture to show on a screen. She sent it to me last night. But so that's something that we have to get back on the horn and schedule, because we have a lot to
share. Keep that going, and I should, and we're gonna have to stop it.
Yeah.
Can we do a lightning round where you'll give your two questions? But I just wanna say for Tina and for Anita, they both have so generously, in addition to serving their country, they continue to serve their country in a host of ways, in addition to doing this, doing their oral histories for us at the Miller Center on the presidents and the first ladies they have served.
Thank you.
And when those come out, you will hear even more stories about what they did in those roles. So can we get a lightning round of two quick questions and then some quick answers?
Yes, and I want to reiterate the thanks to you all for being part of this, and the panel's been amazing. It's been wonderful to hear all of the stories.
Is that Molly?
Yes, my name is Molly Boser. I come from the Benjamin Harrison Presidential Site as the coordinator of our Project POTUS program. But I was curious, and if you could kind of consider the breadth of research that you did about the First Ladies, what was something that was most surprising as you studied them, or what was a lesson in leadership or advocacy that you could take away, or even an assumption that challenged the common interpretation of a First Lady that sort of would change, you know, the historical interpretation? Thank you.
Thank you, Molly. And let's go to, we'll do a lightning round. And Brandon, if you don't want to look forward, we'll come back.
Yeah, lightning and quick answers.
Thank you very much.
I want to respond to that one, too, because I want to talk about champions.
I'm Brandon Robinson. I'm a lawyer in North Carolina, and I try never to miss a panel moderated by Barbara Perry.
I know.
Thank you.
When I was reading about presidents as a kid in high school, I remember this debate about when the first modern president emerged. I think I've heard David McCullough say Theodore Roosevelt. Some people say Franklin Roosevelt. But parallel to that, When does not only the office of First Lady, but the holistic role of the First Lady, when in your minds, and I know this might be somewhat subjective, when does the role of the First Lady of the United States become, quote unquote, modern?
So can we just go down the row, and again, we're going to do this quickly. And by the way, if you have other questions or comments, I think all of us will be at the reception, so please come forward then. We'll just go down the row and just go ahead and just say one person's name, and then we'll get to the previous question.
Starting with Nancy.
Nancy, who's the beginning of the modern First Lady?
Eleanor Roosevelt.
Diana?
I think probably Eleanor.
Yeah.
Anita?
I would say that.
And I'd have
that was
to agree.
Easy. That was very the easy. Three sisters agree.
Yeah, because she, as you mentioned, she steps so far out that they actually have to step back from that as they follow and then reorganize themselves as they come along based on themselves, the presidency, et cetera. Right. And the most surprising thing that you discovered in doing the book, go down the road quickly.
I know.
Nancy, most surprising thing in doing the research?
Edith Roosevelt, one for me.
Pretty surprising to me that Edith Roosevelt helped him get the Nobel Peace Prize. I mean, I thought I knew a lot about first ladies and everything. I had not heard that, and I thought that was pretty surprising.
Was probably the biggest surprise I found, and this is not in the textbook because I didn't find it until this summer when we were working on the other book. Jane Pierce was called the ghost of the White House. For 2 years, she was in mourning. She didn't come out of her room. She held seances. She wrote letters. She had her aunt and even Verena Davis helping her out. But she convinced her husband to let Charles Robinson, who was who became the first governor of the state of Kansas. This is during Bleeding Kansas. This is during the border war with Missouri when we were fighting to get a constitution that was a free state. Her husband imprisoned Charles Robinson and a group of people who were trying to get a free state constitution for being rebels. And Mrs. Robinson and one of Jane Pierce's cousins, who was a friend of the founder of Lawrence, Kansas, and the free state movement, wrote to Jane and said, "We need to get this man out of prison because he's an important leader." And Jane got him out of prison, got Franklin Pierce to turn his...
That'll be in the second edition.
What is second edition?
Big surprise.
Anita, which I assure you will be coming. I can assure you there will be a second and multiple editions. Anita, your most surprising story.
No, the Edith Roosevelt one was too, and it struck me because, you know, I worked in the White House for so long and sat in the Roosevelt room at a senior staff meeting every morning, would look at that Peace Prize, and I never thought for a minute that, you know, Edith Roosevelt had a role to play in that. Yeah. And there were definitely others, but that was striking.
So we could go on, but I have a Germanic background, so we will have to stop now. And I want to thank, of course, Nancy, Diana, and Anita for this book, for this panel that really tied together so many of our themes from the last 3 days. Yeah. And I can assure you that you all, the three of you, will go down in history for bringing this to life.
Well, thank you. Am I first, Stewart?
You are first, always.
Okay, oh, thank you. I think I have. Well, we're at our closing of the summit. Thank you to our incredible panel. I was honored to be part of it. This has been just such a great 3 days. It's been very, very busy. You all have hung in there with us. It's thrilling to see a full room at the end of a three-day summit. I think that speaks a lot for how we've tried to organize this gathering, how we have responded to the things you all have asked for over the last two summits as well. And this is the results of that. We want to thank, of course, our sponsor, Boeing. I want to thank the amazing staff at the White House Historical Association. They
They have knocked it out of the park for all of us and for all of you, and to our events company, Show Call and Stratus. Terrific job at all of our venues and here. This has really been an incredible 3 days. This is going to be hard, Stewart, for you and I to be, or for the Historical Association to be next. And I think I don't have anything else to say beyond that, but we'll enjoy a fun reception together, and I look forward to getting your feedback. We'll be sending you surveys, of course, for the future. But again, thank you, everyone. I've enjoyed being part of this.
Thank you, Barbara, and the panel for that last but best of the day of the past 3 days. So we really appreciate that. All the panelists and all the participants have been extraordinary. This has been a great 3 days, and even though we episodically convene this every 2 years, we don't want the relationships, the collaboration, the partnerships that are forged at these events to wait another 2 years. We want this to continue. That's been one of the beautiful parts of the way this schedule has been arranged, is you've had time to engage with each other and ideate on things and to collaborate, and we hope that will continue, and we want to be your partner on things as well. I'd like to recognize two of my colleagues, Grace McCaffrey and Matt Costello. Where are you? Come forward, take a bow. Yes, Grace. And there's Matt right here. This happens sort of rarely, but last week they briefed me from soup to nuts on everything, and we were in the conference room, went through everything, and at the end I said, "That's great," and Matt said, "That's it?" Yep, I feel comfortable and confident with everything. They've really been terrific, and all of our staff colleagues that are here that have been working behind the scenes doing things that I didn't even know needed to be done, really have never been more proud to be part of a staff team like this. Our extraordinary board led by John Rogers, who opened our program at the White House the other night and is with us here for the reception, our other board members and National Council members that you've met, really an extraordinary group of people committed to the mission that was begun at the White House Historical Association 62 plus years ago. And we continue to be inspired by Mrs. Kennedy and her life and her leadership and her legacy. And it's our privilege to be her living legacy for conservation, preservation, restoration, and education about the White House and its history. So now we're going to adjourn across the hall. You're going to get your raffle tickets for the prizes that we're going to give away. And we're going to celebrate our time together. And be safe on your way home. Stay in touch. And we look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you so much.
Please make your way to the East Room for the closing reception.